And today I would like to discuss imagery, a literary device that is used in literature. Mostly it is used in poetry. So in this lecture we are going to talk about imagery. What is imagery and what do we understand by imagery? Imagery is a selection of those words which are going to arouse sensory experience into our understanding, into our reading of a poem or a literary text. Let's say, for example, we are going to read a poem which is going to create a picture. It is more figurative. It is more pictorial. So here, one sense of our body is going to become active, that is the sense of seeing. So imagery in this way, it activates, it arouses our five senses in one way or other, sometimes all, sometimes one, two, three, sometimes there is a mixture, like it uses one word, but with that word, that image, another sense organ is also activated. So whenever we are reading a poem, whenever we are reading a text, we are to look at the words, the use of sentences which are going to create a sensory effect, in the sense that they are activating our five senses. They are touching upon the senses in a way that they produce a spatial effect. When we read a poem and we visualize a particular scene that is described, a particular moment that is described, and its clear picture is created before our mind, into our mind, then it means that it is pictorial image. So it is called visual image. There are different kinds of images. So visual image is one which creates visual effect through use of words. There is another kind of imagery that is called auditory image. Imagery is termed as image when we are categorizing our experiences, our sensory experiences, activities into groups. The first, or whatever you call it, first, second, third, the first that I am going to introduce is the visual image. One which creates visual picture. It creates either a picture or a whole scene or video that is created through the help of words. Second is auditory image. In auditory image, what happens? In auditory image, we are going to see that our sense of hearing is becoming active with the help of words which are mentioned into the text, like it is using the song of the bird humming, it is using the ripples of the water, it is using some melodious plot, like some instrument which is being played. So when these words are going to be used, our sense of hearing becomes quite active and it tries to see what is the object being played, what kind of sound is it? Is it the sound of a bird? Is it the conversation of a man or woman? Is it the rattling sound that is created when a train is passing on its track? Any kind of sound it can be. I am giving just examples. So when we hear sound, then it is called auditory. The next kind of imagery, you can call it tactile. Tactile imagery activates our sense of touch in the way we feel soft, we feel hard, we feel harshness, roughness. So when we are shown, we are given such words or statements which are going to create our you can say create a sense in which our sense of touch is active. We feel it. That thing is either soft or hard. It is of any kind. Like the cloth, silk cloth is mentioned. It is very soft. Like the rough surface of an object is mentioned. It is rough, but it is giving us tactile image. Sometimes temperature is also the coldness, the heat that is there with the object. It is also sensed with, it is experienced with touching it. So that is also a kind of imagery. So that is called tactile imagery. Tactile imagery, especially when we talk about the sensing of either heat or cold, it also goes into the category of thermal imagery. So thermal imagery, it is related to temperature, either low temperature or high temperature, but it is specifically about temperature. Then we can call it thermal image. Then there is olfactory image. Olfactory image is what? In which our sense of smell is activated. You might have seen that some object is being described, and through the description we see that a kind of fragrance is mentioned, and with that kind of fragrance our sense of smell activates. It gets active. Like you can say very delicious food is being prepared and its aroma is filled into the whole room. So what is the aroma? The smell, the fragrance, the effect. So when our sense of smelling is becoming active, that is called olfactory image. And when our sense of taste is activated, it is called gustatory image. Like sweetness, sour, chill, there are different kinds of tastes. So like when there is mention of wine, with the mention of wine, both kinds of senses become active. Sometimes those people who want to differentiate between other kind of smell and the kind of smell that is produced through wine, then it is having olfactory image, no doubt. But when we are going to eat something, drink something, it creates gustatory image. The taste of wine, the intoxication, the taste of fruit, the taste of honey, the taste of delicious food. So these are the objects, for example, which are going to tell us which sense from our body is going to become active. And depending on the sensory provocation, sensory active experiences, images are described into five categories at major level. When we are going to smell something, it is olfactory. When we are going to taste something, it is gustatory. When we are going to touch something, it is tactile. Whenever we are going to hear something, it is auditory. And whenever we are going to see something, it is visual. Sometimes what happens that with the help of one image, two or more than two senses become active. That is called synesthetic image. Sometimes what happens, two or more than two images are clubbed together. That seems that with one image, another image is being used or it is being created. Like one good song I always mention, for example, that is from the film Rab Ne Bana Di Jodi. In the titular song, when the singer is saying, "Maine apni aankhon se tumhe chhu liya." This is the best example of synesthetic image. We never touch somebody with our eyes. But here, the poet or the singer or the lyric writer has created a different effect See, visual image is used for tactile experience. So two experiences, two kinds of senses are clubbed in one. So this is synesthetic image. So at broader level, there are five senses into our body. With the help of these five senses, we experience different kinds of images, and images, when they are experienced into different way, they are put into the you can say main heading of imagery. Imagery is generally concerned with our sensory experiences. With the help of five experiencing senses, we can also produce a few more experiences, like mentioned temperature, like you see synesthetic image. There is one kind of image which is again part of somewhere visual image, but that is depending on the object. It is not experienced at first hand by the reader, by the person. See, that is called kinetic image or kinesthetic image, in which there is a movement, there is a dynamic activity which is happening. One place to another, the object, the person is moving. When there is movement of an object, of a person, from one place to another place, that kind of image is called kinesthetic image. Kinetic, you know the meaning of kinetic. So kinetic energy, in which there is movement. So this kind of imagery has been derived or has been given title with that particular word, kinetic or kinesthetic. So these are some types of images which are generally used into literary texts, and most specifically they are found into poetry. Most sensuous poem, or the rich poem written by any author, is the poems written by John Keats. But almost all romantic poets, they are rich in imagery, they are figurative, they are pictorial. You can move to Victorian poetry. Victorian poetry is also figurative, but here the writer is limiting the use of senses. In the way John Keats uses, nobody uses senses. Read his one poem, one ode, you will find that all your five senses become active at some steps. But other writers, they don't arouse all the five senses in one poem, but John Keats does that in many of his poems. So any kind of poetry can have imagery, there is no doubt, even though it is difficult, but it is having a pictorial effect on the mind of the reader. So generally all poems become pictorial. Some poems which are very philosophical, they are not as much figurative, but they also have use of metaphor, use of simile to make it more figurative. And in the next lecture, or in one more lecture, I shall discuss how figures of speech are used to create these figurative experiences or figurative descriptions into a poem. Thank you for today. I shall discuss the remaining topics in the next video.